Happy Sunday, Foundation Church. Another Sunday is upon us, and today's service is going to be incredible. I hope you're as excited as we are. In just a moment, we're going to give you some instructions, some directions on things you can do during this time while you're waiting for the countdown. But the very first and most important thing you can do is open yourselves up to all that God has in store for you today.
This is our time where you gather everybody in your family, get everyone ready, turn up the volume. If you're already all ready, comment, let us know you're here. This is a perfect time for people to chat while we're waiting for the service to begin.
By the way, the service is going to begin really soon. As a matter of fact, it's going to begin in four minutes.
Choose this day to be grateful, Lord. I give you praise with an open heart. I'm waking up to heaven. I'm waking up to you. I'm waking up to heaven. Waking up to heaven. Oh, I'm waking up to you. I choose this day to be grateful, Lord. I give you praise with an open heart. I'm waking up to heaven. Oh, I'm waking up to you. Waking up to heaven. I'm waking up to heaven. Oh, I'm waking up to you. For always being good. For always being good, oh thank you, for your mercies that are new, oh thank you, in spirit and in truth, oh thank you, I'm telling you thank you. Your faithfulness like the sunrise, your endless love reaching past the skies. I'm waking up to heaven. I'm waking up to you. I'm waking up to heaven.
My joy to thank you.
morning, church. We're so excited you guys are joining us online. Not going to lie, we do miss you being in this building with us, but we're going to worship with you guys, and we hope that you guys worship with us at home. I think the stone's getting ready to roll. I feel a faith that is starting to rise. And I see a world on the edge of revival. I think it's only a matter of time. But do what only you can do. Move what only you can move. Even the impossible is possible for you. I see a grave that is hollow of power. I see a battle that's already won. And I see a church on the verge of revival. I see your kingdom has already come. But do it only you can do. It's possible for you. You can make the chains come loose. You can tell the mountains move. Even the impossible is possible for you. Even the impossible is possible for you. You said it, I see. You still do miracles. There's power in Jesus' name. All darkness defeated. There's nothing stopping you, my God. There's nothing stopping you. You said it, I see it. You still do miracles. There's power in Jesus' name. All darkness defeated. There's nothing stopping you, my God. There's nothing stopping you. Do what only you can do. Move what only you can move. Even the impossible is possible for you. You can make the chains come loose. You can tell the mountains move. Even the impossible is possible for you. Well, even the impossible is possible for you. You said it, I see it. You still do miracles. There's power in Jesus' name. All darkness defeated. There's nothing stopping you, my God. There's nothing stopping you. There's nothing stopping you. There's nothing stopping you.
Good morning and welcome back to Foundation Church. Thank you so much again for joining us online today. If this is your first time, your second time, your third time, hey, go ahead and comment down below and let us know you're here. As a matter of fact, even if this isn't your first, second, or third time, comment and let us know you're with us today. We are so excited to be worshiping with you. This is the place in our service where normally we invite the kids to come up, we play some kind of game, we do something sort of fun. Obviously, that's not going to work quite the same today. So what we would love for all the kids to do, kids, are you ready? I would love for you to give me your biggest, your hugest, your most giant smile. 1, 2, 3, now.
All right, church, we're going to invite you to keep singing with us this morning about the love of Jesus Christ. It's so great. Amen. Your love so great, Jesus in all things. I've seen a glimpse of your heart a billion years, and still I'll be singing. How can I praise you enough? How can I praise you enough? You are the Lord Almighty, outshining all the stars in glory. Your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares. Creation calls all to the Savior. We are alive for your praise in earth and sky. No one is higher. Our God of wonders, you reign. Our God of wonders, you reign. You are the Lord. the stars in glory. Your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares.
Darkest day remains.
count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy and all my days. Yes, I will. One thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will.
This is like the coolest part of our service. This is the place in the service where you have an opportunity to talk to God. Wherever you are, God is there with you. And you can talk to God about whatever is on your mind, whatever is on your heart, whatever's going on in your life. In just a minute, I'm going to give you a few moments to silently speak to God. At the conclusion of that silent prayer, though, we're going to bring our voices together in the Lord's Prayer. If that's a new prayer, if you just want to make sure you're saying the right words, we're going to put that right up on the screen for you. So don't be afraid to open your eyes at that point and read those words. With that instruction given, I'm going to invite you to join me in an attitude of prayer. Today. Good stuff, bad stuff, happy things, scary things. remind us not only of your presence, not only of your power and your desire to save us, but your trustworthiness, Lord. May we find ourselves trusting you, even when it feels like everything is spinning out of control. God Almighty, hear our prayers as now we pray the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Good morning, and thank you once again for joining us here at Foundation Church. Today we are beginning a brand new series entitled From Fear to Faith. This is a series that's going to be designed, hopefully, to help us overcome those fears, whatever they are in our lives, both big and small. And it's going to give us some real practical steps, some tips from people in your Bible who overcame big fears and how they did it. So today we're going to kick this series off by talking about living with lions. And let me tell you, lions are scary. Amen? I mean, lions are huge. They grow to be 300 to 400 pounds on average. They are fast. They run 50 miles an hour. By the way, that's like twice as fast as the fastest human being who's ever run. And oh, by the way, lions are ravenous meat-eating machines. They can eat up to 60 pounds of meat in one sitting. That's scary stuff. Now, I have to be honest, though, I don't have a lot of experience with lions, and I'm guessing probably a lot of you outside of seeing them in a zoo or on TV or maybe on Tiger King, come on, be honest, probably a lot of you don't have a lot of experience with lions either. And so I'm going to talk about something else that's really scary. Cars are scary. Amen. I mean, cars on average are 2,500, that's 2,500 pounds plus. Cars on average can go over 100 miles an hour. And get ready for it, this is the scariest part. Cars are always or often controlled by people who aren't themselves always in control. Cars are often controlled by those who are themselves not always under control. And that makes cars scary and way, way, way deadlier than lions. Now, this truth was impressed upon me as a 16-year-old boy by both of my parents upon learning to drive a car. Actually, it was impressed upon me somewhere between the ages of 12 to 16 before learning to drive a car. My parents wanted to be sure I knew that cars were scary. Cars were dangerous. They said, if you are not ever vigilant, always focused, you could die in a moment. Now, obviously, these are two loving parents who wanted to make sure that their teenage boy was safe once he finally got behind the wheel of a car. What this did, though, was it made me just terrified of cars and especially of driving a car. Now, in a minute, I'm going to tell you about my first experience, very first experience taking a car on the road. The car that I took on the road was a 1988 Oldsmobile station wagon. Yeah, the kind with the wood paneling on the sides. Beautiful, beautiful. My parents figured it was the biggest, heaviest, slowest, safest hunk of junk that I could drive around the roads of Owego, New York. I would love it, though, if you would take a minute and comment down below, what car did you learn to drive with? What was that first vehicle that you hit the roads with yourself? Now, I was in my 1988 Oldsmobile station wagon. I was excited and, again, really, really afraid of driving this car. With my father in the passenger seat, it was just the two of us, just the guys, for my first maiden voyage in a car. And we went out to drive it, and we got to a three-way stop sign. Now, this three-way stop sign, you could see it from my house, so we didn't make it very, very far. But when we got to it, I was really nervous about turning my car left to go onto the next road. And so there was a car to my right stopped. I motioned them along. And my dad said, all right, that's fine, that's okay, it's better safe than sorry. You guys both came to the stop signs about the same time. Now you can go. Well, then I saw a car to my left, and I said, I don't know, Dad, I'm not sure if they know I'm going to go. So I motioned them along. Well, at this point, cars are starting to queue up, line up behind me, right? And I'm looking behind me, and my dad said, all right, John, it's okay. but you need to turn left now. You need to go ahead and turn left. Well, while he was saying that, another car pulled up, and I motioned them along. And finally, my father said, if you motion another car along, I'm going to make you get out of the seat, and I'm going to drive. To which I responded, yeah, maybe that's the best. Maybe I should get out, and you should drive the rest of the way, and we'll do this tomorrow. Now, thankfully, my dad didn't let me do that. He said to me, and I'll never forget these words, he said, I understand that you're a little scared, that driving a car is understandably a scary thing. He said, but John, in order to overcome your fear, you must face your fear. In order to overcome your fear, you must face your fear. And then he said to me, and oh, by the way, I'm right here with you. Now, this advice was incredibly valuable. I eventually did turn left. I think I only waved on a couple more cars. And I eventually got to the point where I wasn't absolutely paralyzed by fear every time I got into a car. But early on, it was hard. I had to force myself to get in the car and to drive and to turn, even when I was scared. Today, I'm going to be reading you a story of a guy who had some experience not with cars, but with lions. A guy who had some experience with some fear and who came out on the other side with more than a little story to tell. That story is the story of Daniel. I'm going to be reading from Daniel chapter 6, verses 16 all the way to verse 23. You can go ahead and find that in your Bibles if you want, although we will put that on the screen for you also. But before I read that story, there's a couple things I want to highlight. The first thing is Daniel was what was known as a Hebrew or a Jew, right? He was from the country of the country of Israel, and he was from the southern part of that country. Daniel's story takes place in a country called Babylon. Babylon was like the big kids on the block. They were the powerful country at the time, and they had actually deported a whole bunch of people from Daniel's country to their country. And so Daniel's part of those deportees, those who were taken from their home and sent to Babylon. The other thing that's important to understand is Daniel and all of the Jews or the Hebrews were what we call monotheists. That means one God. They believed in one God. They believed you could only pray to one God. You could only worship one God. The Babylonians were what we call polytheists. This means that they believed that you could pray to many gods and you could worship many gods. And for the Babylonians, those gods could be like up in the sky and invisible, but they could also be human beings walking around on the earth as physical representatives of the gods. And so this difference between monotheism, one god, and polytheism, two gods, this sets up a plot to get Daniel in trouble. Because it turns out that in exile, as one of those deportees, Daniel separated himself in a good way from all of the other people in the land. And the king of Babylon, King Darius was his name, the king of Babylon thought so highly of Daniel, this lowly Hebrew deportee, that he was going to make him in charge of everything. Now, the other leaders in Babylon got wind of this. They didn't like it, and so they came up with a plot, a scheme to get Daniel in trouble. Now, at first, they tried to dig up dirt. They said everyone's got a skeleton in their closet, but lo and behold, they couldn't find anything on Daniel. But what they did figure out was that as a monotheist, as a believer in only one God, who was very devoted and very committed to his faith, Daniel would only pray to God and to no others. And so what they did was they went to their king and they said, King, we should do something special for you. You're so important. We want to have everyone for 30 days pray only to you, King. And anyone who does anything otherwise, anyone who prays to any other gods, they should be put to death. They should be thrown in a lion's den. Now, they had the king, King Darius, sign a piece of paper saying that he agreed to this. Now, what this did was this cemented the law, right? It was like writing it in stone. It couldn't be changed. And that's where we pick up on our story today, because it turns out that Daniel prayed to his God anyway. He did it just like he had always done it. And when he was caught, he didn't deny it. He said, you're right. I did pray to my God. And so that's where our story picks up. It's again Daniel chapter 6. I'm going to be reading verses 16 through 23. So the king gave the order, and they brought Daniel and threw him into the lion's den. The king said to Daniel, may your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you. a stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the rings of his nobles, so that Daniel's situation might not be changed. Then the king returned to his place and spent the night without eating and without any entertainment being brought to him, and he could not sleep. At the first light of dawn, the king got up and hurried to the lion's den. When he came near the den, he called to Daniel in an anguished voice, "Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to rescue you from the lions?" Daniel answered, "May the king live forever. My God sent his angel, and he shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me, because I was found innocent in his sight. Nor have I ever done any wrong before you, your majesty." The king was overjoyed and gave orders to lift Daniel out of the den. And when Daniel was lifted from the den, no wound was found on him, because he had trusted in his God. This is God's word. It's given freely to each and every one of you. So I want to draw you back to verse 16. In verse 16, we have a very concerned, very worried King Darius almost breaking out into a prayer as he calls after Daniel. Daniel has just been placed into the lion's den. You can almost imagine they're rolling the stone over the opening. And King Darius calls out, "May your God, whom you serve continually, save you from the lions." Now, I want to highlight that word "save," because it turns out that our English translation is not doing us any favors here. You need to understand that this part of your Bible was written in a language called Hebrew, and that language is far more specific than a lot of the words that we use in English. And specifically with this word "save," the Hebrew word that was used there, the word actually means to deliver or free. And so the king isn't just shouting out after Daniel, "Hey, may God make it go well for you," right? This generic, "I hope it goes okay. I hope to see you again." But it's a really specific, "I hope that you are delivered. I hope you are freed from the lion's den." And what we have King Darius here doing is, if not praying, this is like a halfway prayer to this God that may or may not exist. Remember, King Darius is a polytheist. He believes in a bunch of gods. He's not sure if this God is real or not, but he's like, "Hey, if that God's around and he's real and he's powerful, might he free you from the lion's den?" You can almost imagine King Darius as he's sealing the stone in the cave thinking, "Man, I hope somehow his God has transported him out of the cave. He's delivered him from it." If we move on to verse 19, what we have is a king, King Darius, who's so stressed about this. He doesn't eat. He doesn't call for any evening entertainment. He has a hard time sleeping. And he's up bright and early first thing in the morning. Now, I'm not sure about you, but I think a lot of us can relate to King Darius here. As a matter of fact, my guess is a lot of us recently have lost some sleep because of stress. As a matter of fact, if you have lost some sleep because of stress recently, go ahead and comment down below and say, "I can relate. I can relate to this guy." But we find King Darius first thing in the morning, a sleepless night, hurrying, we're told. Now, the word there is like an anxious, stressed out running, right? He's racing to the tomb, hopefully, or to the lion's den, hopefully, to find an alive and well Daniel. Now, let's move on to verse 22. Here we've gotten to the payoff, right? King Darius has called in, and Daniel has called back out. And in verse 22, Daniel says in response to the king, "My God has shut the mouths of the lions," right? My God has shut the mouths of the lions. And it's really clear here, Daniel's being very specific about how he was saved from these lions, right? He wasn't transported out. He wasn't magically able to overpower the lions, but rather God closed their mouths so that they didn't harm him. And if we went on to verse 23, we're told he's pulled out and there was no wound or no injury because he trusted in his God. Well, let's go back to that title of today's message, Living with Lions, because I got to be honest, we're not talking about cars today. We're not really talking about lions. What we're talking about is anything in your life that you're afraid of, anything that brings stress into your world, anything that scares you or frightens you, specifically things that might scare you to the point where you feel a little paralyzed by fear. Now, obviously, the elephant in the room as we're talking about this today is the coronavirus. right? Is this COVID-19 is the reason why so many of us are in our homes and haven't left our homes, or are afraid when we do leave our homes, why many of our jobs have stopped, and why so much turmoil and anxiety is going on in this world, all around the world. Now, I want to be really, really clear. There's a couple things I want to highlight for you. I am not meddling in politics, and I dare not get into that today. That is not my goal. So if you're looking for a political message, turn on the news, turn on one of the politicians. That is not what I'm talking about. The other thing that I want to make really clear here is I'm not trying to set up some science versus faith, some you know, academia versus religion kind of thing. I'm a big both and guy. I'm a big fan that we can use our brains and believe in science and have faith. So if you're hearing that, that's not my intention. I'm not trying to set that up. But what I am going to do here today is hopefully give you a little bit of good news in the midst of this and set the scene for the rest of this series. Because for the rest of this series, we're going to look at specific characters in your Bible who've encountered very specific fears, and we're going to look at how they overcame those and hopefully learn to apply those techniques, those strategies to our own lives and to ourselves. But let's go back to Daniel, because there's something really cool going on here. If we look at verse 16, that's the very beginning of what I read. And we look at verse 22, that's nearly the end of what I read. In verse 16, we have the king, King Darius, saying, "May your God free you. May your God deliver you," right? Darius is being really specific in what he wants for Daniel. And it's namely for Daniel to be taken out of that situation. And I bet there's a lot of you listening today who wish that you could just be taken out of the hardship or the struggle or the challenging situations that you find yourself in. And yet in verse 22, we have Daniel explaining what God did on his behalf. And the solution that God provides is completely different. Daniel says that God, or the angel of the Lord, shut the lion's mouths. Daniel stayed in that lion's den. Friends, I'm going to suggest to you that Daniel was a little scared, that he probably did not sleep much, and he probably kept both eyes on those lions and kept himself as far away as possible. And yet at the end of this ordeal, he's able to say God was faithful, God shut their mouths, God saved me from this lion's den. I want to suggest that the same is true in your life with the fears and the anxieties that you experience. Sometimes we pray to God very, very specifically, "Lord, do this. Lord, do that. God, if only you could, please." And I want to suggest that oftentimes God is incredibly, profoundly, amazingly faithful to us, but in a completely different way. Sometimes in such a different way that we don't even recognize it as God, or give God the credit for the way that that is. So going back to that whole science and faith thing, both and, look, friends, if social distancing, shutting down, wearing masks, inoculations, vaccines, if that's all effective, and 6 months from now we say, "Hey, we've defeated the coronavirus as a species," I'm still going to shout from the mountaintops, God was faithful to us. Just the same as if tomorrow we all wake up and there is no coronavirus and there's no explanation and it's only able to be explained as miraculous, I'm just the same going to shout from the mountaintops, God was faithful to us. What I'm trying to point out here is that sometimes we ask for one thing and God gives us what we ask for in a way that we weren't asking, in a way that we weren't looking for, in a way that we didn't realize. All of this goes to this truth that, yeah, lions and cars and diseases, that's scary stuff. That's stuff that oftentimes can scare us to the point where we say, "I don't want to go outdoors. I don't want to deal with this. I'm afraid of this. I just want to curl up in my bed under my warm, cozy blankets and stay right here." And yet I want to bring back those words that my father said to a very scared and very nervous and very much paralyzed with fear 16-year-old me. "In order to overcome your fear, you must face your fear." And then, friends, I want to share these good words with you. Just like my dad was right there with me, your God, your Heavenly Father, God is whispering to you, "I'm right here with you." No matter what's before you today, this week, this month, or this year, no matter how scared or how afraid you are, I want to remind you that you need to first face your fears, and you need to always remember that your God, He's right here with you. With that in mind, I'm going to invite you to join me in a word of prayer. God, may we find ourselves continually marveling at the might and the power of your creation, and at the same time marveling at the glory of your goodness and the incredible faithfulness that you show to us. Lord, may we not only marvel, but may we share that good news with others, that they too might hear that you are right here with us. Lord God, help us to face the future, whether it be certain or uncertain, unafraid, knowing that you are by our side. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As a matter of fact, friends, if you prayed that prayer with me today, if you were asking God to help you overcome whatever fears are going on in your life, I want you to go ahead and comment down below and say, Lord, help me overcome my fear. Lord, help me overcome my fears. Now, with that said, we are nearing the completion of this service. I know it's hard to believe that the service is almost over. We're going to bring the worship team back. They're going to give you one more chance to praise and worship God in just in a mighty, incredible way. But while that's happening, we also want to give you a chance to get back to God. Now look, if this is your first, your second, or your third time with us, we just want to hear from you. We just want to know that you're with us. We're so excited that you've chosen to join us today. We don't want any kind of monetary gift. We just want you to say, hey, I'm here for the third time, or I'm here for the second time, or maybe even I'm here for the first time. If you've been here more than three times and you want to be a part of supporting what we here at Foundation Church are doing, that is building community, making a difference in this world, and helping people reclaim their faith, if you want to be a part of that and make that happen, we're going to put a link down below for you to go ahead and give online. But with that direction set, I'm going to invite you to follow the leadership of our worship team one last time.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy through my days. Yes, I will. God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I
I hope today was a fun day for you. It absolutely was awesome for us. In just a minute, I'm going to give you some words of blessing and benediction, some good words, hopefully to take with you wherever you're going. But before I do that, I want to invite you to come on back, same bat channel, same bat time. That's same time, same place, Facebook, to join us for our worship service next week. Next week, we're going to be talking about getting out of the boat. We're going to be looking at the story of Peter walking on the water. And spoiler alert, you got to get out of the boat to walk on the water. With that said, friends, I hope you receive these words of blessing and benediction today. May you go forth with the God who shuts the mouths of lions. May you go forth trusting in him and unafraid. Go with Christ and go in his peace. Amen.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. Sing a little louder.